Welcome back. In the previous class, we looked into various BJT biasing circuits. So you are aware what is a BJT, what are the different configuration in which a BJT can be connected, and why do we need biasing, and what are the different biasing circuits we have with BJT. So moving on, the next topic of our discussion in module 1 is the op-amp application circuits. So you have op-amp application circuits, wherein we will be looking into various op-amp application circuits. So you are aware what op-amp is. Op-amp is an eigen differential voltage amplifier, and it has several advantages, characteristics of your op-amp you have already studied in your basic electronics. And few of the application, fundamental applications of op-amp, like op-amp as an integrator, differentiator, adder, you have already discussed. Now we will take up more advanced op-amp application circuits, just to list a few which we will be discussing today and in the next class is a peak detector, peak voltage detector. We discuss how an op-amp is used as a Schmitt trigger, what are the different types of Schmitt triggers available, and we will also look into the active filters. So what is a filter? Filter is basically a circuit which passes the wanted signal and blocks the unwanted signal, and how to construct active filters using op-amp we will discuss. And followed by this, we have what is called as non-linear amplifier, relaxation oscillator. Given a voltage source, convert it into a current source, voltage to current converter, and current to voltage converter. Today's class, we will take up the first few applications of your op-amp, that is op-amp as a peak detector, followed by the discussion on op-amp as a Schmitt trigger. So the very first application circuit which we are going to discuss is op-amp as a peak detector. So op-amp can be used as a peak detector. So what do we mean by peak detector? So a peak detector is a circuit which can be used to determine the peak value in a given input signal. So this is basically a circuit designed to measure the peak value in the input signal. So your conventional AC voltmeters, which is used to measure the voltage, peak value of AC input voltage, works fine with sinusoidal signal. So the example of your sinusoidal signal includes a sine wave, anything which alternates between two values, a set of positive and negative values, we call it as an AC signal. So we have an AC signal, a sinusoidal is an example of AC signal, a square wave is an example of AC signal, a triangular wave is an example of AC signal. We have what is called as sawtooth waveform, that is also an AC signal. So the conventional AC meters, they are designed to measure the peak value of your sinusoidal signal, and it fails in measuring the peak value of other AC signals. So in order to measure the peak value of other AC signals, we have what is called as peak detector. So we will first introduce a very basic peak detector using op-amp, and then we will use a modified version of your peak detector and see what enhancement has been done to the basic peak detector circuit. So we will take up the basic peak detector circuit. Your op-amp peak detector, the input is applied, AC input is applied through a diode into the non-inverting terminal of your op-amp. So we need two power supplies to drive your op-amp, plus VCC and minus VCC, and here we include a capacitor and a MOSFET switch. One of the application of your MOSFET is as a switch. We include metal oxide, semiconductor, field effector, switch. So you could have any switch. Here we have specifically mentioned it as a MOSFET switch. So, and we have a capacitor. And please note, the output, this circuit acts as a voltage follower because the output is connected back to the input. So, it acts as a voltage follower. And the working of your, when the working of your peak detector goes something like this. Positive off of your cycle of the input AC signal forward biases your diode, and the capacitor is charged through this forward biased diode. So your capacitor is charged to the peak value of input signal through the forward biased diode. So once the capacitor is completely charged, it acts as a voltage source, and when I close the switch, what happens is this capacitor discharges through this non-inverting terminal. And because this peak detector is connected as a voltage follower, because this peak detector is connected as the voltage follower, the output maintains the peak value, the output is retained at the peak value of the capacitor. So till the next peak arises, till the capacitor is charged to the next peak value. So in this way, the op-amp detects the peak value in the peak value of your input voltage. So we will try to modify this basic peak detector circuit by including one more peak detector, by including one more operational amplifier, wherein one of the operational amplifier acts as a voltage follower and the other provides other acts as a buffer amplifier providing isolation. So to this basic peak detector circuit, we add one more operational amplifier and see how the peak detector can be modified with an enhanced operation. So what we have is modified peak detector. As I said, we include one more operational amplifier. Let me call the first amplifier as A1. This is diode B1, and as usual you have a capacitor, and we have the second op-amp, let me call it as A2. So the input is applied through resistance R1 to the non-inverting terminal of your first op-amp, and the same, the output of first operational amplifier is applied to the non-inverting terminal of the second op-amp, and you are aware it is connected as a voltage follower. So you can see resistor R1 . So here op-amp A1 acts as a voltage follower, and this acts as a op-amp A2 acts as a buffer amplifier. So when I say it is acting as a buffer amplifier, it provides isolation between the input and output circuit. So as usual, your input is fed into the non-inverting terminal of the first op-amp, and your diode is forward biased due to the when the input signal is positive. As a result, the capacitor is charged to the peak value. This capacitor discharges through the non-inverting terminal, and because it is connected as a voltage amplifier, the output is retained to the positive peak. So every time your peak value changes, say this is my input. So every time the peak value changes, your V0 changes to the new peak. So initially it is a old circuit. So it is, the output is going to be V0, and it holds this value. Even if the input drops, it holds this particular peak value unless a new peak arises. So this way it is detecting at any point of any instant of time, it retains the most peak value observed so far. So this is how your peak detector works. And please note, the diode D2 here prevents the amplifier from going into negative saturation. So, and we select the value of R1 and R2 equals. We usually take the values of R1 and R2 equal, and diode D2, what you see here, is used to prevent the output from going into positive saturation. So this is a peak detector circuit wherein the operational amplifier is used as a part of your peak detector circuit, wherein the output is at any instant of time is proportional to the most peak value in the input. So it at any instant is the peak value of the input so far. So next we will take up a Smith trigger. So the next application circuit is a Smith trigger. So we will discuss what a Smith trigger is, what are the different variants of Smith trigger, and we will try to design few Smith trigger circuits as well. So the next application is op amp as a Smith trigger. So before jumping into what a Smith trigger is, so let me tell one of the applications of your op amp is as a comparator. So what is a comparator? So because it has two terminals, it runs with two supply plus VCC and minus VCC, and you have what is called as inverting terminal and a non-inverting terminal. So we will call the voltage at the inverting terminal as V1 and this as V2. So basically this particular any operational amplifier, it acts as a comparator. So what do you mean by comparator? So comparator is a circuit which compares between two values. So here the two values are the two inputs. So when V1 is greater than V2, what happens? The voltage at the non-inverting terminal is greater than that at the inverting terminal. So as a result, the output is going to be driven to positive saturation and you will see a high voltage. And similarly, when your input at the non-inverting terminal is less than that of the inverting terminal, what happens is the output is driven to negative saturation, and as a result you will see the output goes to be a low. It will be driven to a negative saturation. This is a basic comparator. So but with a basic comparator, what we see is under the influence of noise, if the input signal is under the influence of noise, you see unwanted transitions at the output. You will observe unwanted transitions at the output. So in order to eliminate the effect of noise at the input causing unwanted transitions at the output, we go with what is called as Smith triggers. So Smith triggers, they are basically comparators with hysteresis. I can call Smith triggers as comparators with hysteresis. So they are basically comparators wherein you see the phenomenon of hysteresis, which eliminates the effect of noise on the output signal and thereby avoiding unwanted transitions at the output. And you can also call the Smith triggers as wave shaping circuits. So these are the various applications. In turn, when I term out the different names of Smith trigger, I am referring to their different applications of Smith triggers. I can call Smith triggers as wave shaping circuits. So when I say wave shaping circuit, what I mean is you give any irregularly shaped waveform, you give a sine wave or you give any waveform at the input, the output is going to be a square wave. So that is the reason we call it as a square wave generator. So based on what intention you are using your Smith trigger, we can call it as comparator with hysteresis, wherein it compares the two values, two input values, and accordingly drives the output to either high or low depending on the two input values there, and also eliminating what the effect of noise. So that is why we call it as comparators with hysteresis. Or if you are using your Smith triggers, this particular Smith trigger, to convert a sine wave to square wave or any irregularly shaped waveform to a square wave, we term them as wave shaping circuits. So we will look into what are the different available Smith triggers. So based on whether you are applying input to the inverting terminal or the non-inverting terminal, we have two variants of Smith trigger. The one, the first one is inverting Smith trigger. So if you are applying the input to the inverting terminal of your op amp Smith trigger circuit, we call it as inverting Smith trigger. And if you are applying the input to the non-inverting terminal of the Smith trigger circuit, we call it as non-inverting Smith trigger. And basically, whether it be it inverting or a non-inverting Smith triggers are circuit with positive voltage feedback. So what do I mean by positive voltage feedback? So when I say it has positive voltage feedback, what I mean is a portion of output is connected back to the positive terminal or the non-inverting terminal of the input. Thus, when the output is at positive saturation, we have positive reference voltage. We will have positive, providing a positive reference voltage when the output is at plus Vsat, and if the output is at minus Vsat, again a portion of your output is connected to back to the inverting, non-inverting terminal, providing a negative reference voltage. This is what I mean when I call a Smith trigger as a positive voltage feedback circuit. So if the output is at positive saturation, the reference is voltage is plus V reference, and if the output is at negative saturation, the reference voltage is minus V reference. So we will take up each type of Smith trigger, that is an inverting Smith trigger and a non-inverting Smith trigger, and we will also see to the variations in these Smith triggers. We will start with each one of them one by one. So inverting Smith trigger is a Smith trigger circuit wherein the input is applied to the inverting terminal of the op amp. So your circuit, it goes something like this. So you are aware it has an inverting terminal, a non-inverting terminal. It is driven by plus VCC and minus VCC, and as I said, the input is applied to the inverting terminal, so that is where we call it as inverting Smith trigger. And as I said, if you try, I can try to recall what I just told. It is a positive feedback, positive voltage feedback. So what I mean is the portion of output is connected back to the input through a voltage divider circuit. So you have through a voltage divider circuit, I connect the output back to the input. So here voltage, the reference voltage at the non-inverting terminal is at any instant V out, the output voltage into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Now we will see the working of your Smith trigger. As I said, it converts any signal to a square wave signal. So if I give a sine wave as input, and please note, all Smith triggers, they switch from I to low or low to high at two trigger points. We call them as upper trigger point and lower trigger points. The switching between, switching from an I to low and low to high happens at these trigger points. So when the input crosses UTP, it switches from one level to other level, or when it falls below LTP, it switches from one level to other level. So we call these as trigger points. So we, let me assume my input is a sine wave, and let me call this as upper trigger point, and let me call this as a lower trigger point. So we design it for a particular upper threshold point and lower threshold point. So, and I will assume the output. So output at any instant switches back and forth between the two values, that is plus positive saturation and the negative saturation. So let me call this as output. So initially, let me assume the output is at plus Vsat. So let me assume the output is at plus Vsat. So as a result, now V naught is what? Plus Vsat. What portion of output is connected back to the input? It is plus Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. and you are aware if you are the, if the input at the non-inverting terminal is greater than the input at the inverting terminal, the output continues to be in its positive saturation. Now, if you want the output to jump from positive saturation to negative saturation, what should happen? The voltage at the input terminal should exceed your UTP. So when the input exceeds the upper threshold point, what happens? Voltage at this point becomes greater than this point. So once the voltage at the inverting terminal becomes higher than that of the inverting terminal, the output is driven to what? Negative saturation. So at this point, when input crosses your upper threshold point, the output drops to what is called as minus Vsat. Now the reference voltage is what? Output is at minus Vsat, and what is the reference voltage? So your reference voltage becomes minus Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So because the output is now the reference voltage is minus Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Earlier it was plus Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Now because the input voltage is greater than the reference voltage, it continues to be in negative saturation. Now when the input falls below this value, below minus Vsat into R2 by R1 plus R2, which happens to be the negative or lower threshold point, so once your input falls below the this value, what happens? This again, the input at the non-inverting terminal becomes greater than that of the inverting terminal, and the output switches back to plus Vsat. This continues, and you can see this continues. So as a result, as I said earlier, your input wave is converted into a square output, or otherwise it acts as a comparator with the hysteresis. So the output at any instant is at positive saturation or negative saturation, depending on whether the input crosses these two threshold points. So that is where we call it as when input crosses, when Vin is greater than upper threshold point, it switches to minus Vsat. And when input falls below the lower threshold point, it switches to plus Vsat. Okay, so we will see how to determine these upper threshold point and lower threshold point. Again, your upper threshold point and lower threshold point, what it depends on? It depends on R2 and R1. So the choice of R1 and R2 allows you to design a circuit with the required threshold points. We will see what these threshold points are. So I will just write what these threshold points are here. So as you are aware, so your upper threshold point, VUTP is plus Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2, and lower threshold point VLTP is minus Vsat into R2 by R1 plus R2. Now because I say it is a comparator with hysteresis, we call the hysteresis as the difference between upper and lower threshold points. So can I write it as UTP minus LTP? So if I do so, it is Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2, minus of minus becomes plus, Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So this is going to be 2 into R2 divided by R1 plus R2 into Vsat. So you can see what is R2 by R1 plus R2. It is a feedback factor. It depends on these resistance value, which are connected as the feedback. So I will replace, I will call beta is equal to R2 by R1 plus R2 as the feedback circuit. Thereby your hysteresis is going to be 2 beta into R2 divided by R1 plus. So this is here, this is the expression for your hysteresis. Now we will see the hysteresis curve. So your hysteresis curve looks something like this. I will write V in along the y axis and V naught along the V in along the V naught along the y axis and V in along the x axis. So we assume initially the output is at plus V sat. It is at positive saturation. It continues to be in positive saturation until your input falls below your upper threshold point. When your input falls, when your input crosses your upper threshold point, what happens is the output drops from plus positive V saturation to minus V sat. Now it continues to be in minus V sat till the input falls below your lower threshold point. When the input falls below the lower threshold point, what happens? It moves to the positive saturation. So this is how your hysteresis curve looks like. So when input crosses your upper threshold point, the output switches from plus Vsat to minus Vsat, and the same way when input falls below the lower threshold point, it switches from negative saturation to positive saturation. This we call it as hysteresis curve. So you can see your hysteresis curve is centered around zero. The hysteresis curve is centered around zero. So if I want to shift the hysteresis curve either to the left or to the right, so what we do is we add a reference voltage here. So if I add a reference voltage here, a positive reference voltage shifts your hysteresis curve to the right of zero reference voltage, and if I add a negative reference voltage, it is shifted to the left of the original hysteresis curve. So we will see how this hysteresis curve can be shifted either to the left or right. So just to put it, summarize everything. So your inverting Smith trigger is a circuit with a positive voltage feedback. When I say positive voltage feedback, the output is connected back to the positive terminal of its input. So because it has positive voltage feedback, if the output is at plus Vsat, it gives a positive reference voltage, and if the output is at minus Vsat, it sets a negative reference voltage. So here, based on whether the input is applied to the inverting terminal or non-inverting terminal, we have two variants of Smith triggers, inverting and non-inverting Smith trigger. Your inverting Smith trigger looks something like this. So we give the input to the inverting terminal and we have a positive feedback. So initially we assume we are supplying a sinusoidal AC input signal to the inverting terminal, and we assume the initial output the output is at positive saturation. Since the output is at positive saturation, it continues to be at positive saturation until the voltage at the inverting terminal is greater than your input at the greater than this reference voltage. And what is the reference voltage? Portion of output is fed back to this input, and this reference voltage is plus Vsat. And what portion? The voltage drop across R2 is applied as the reference voltage. So Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2 becomes the reference voltage. Now the output continues to be in positive saturation till input exceeds this value. Once the input exceeds this value, what happens? The voltage at the inverting terminal becomes greater than that at the non-inverting terminal. As a result, the output is driven to minus Vsat. Now the output continues to be in negative saturation, and what is the feedback voltage? The feedback voltage is minus Vsat into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Now, as long as your input is above this minus Vsat into R2 by R1 plus R2, the output continues to be in negative saturation. Once your input falls below this reference voltage, you can see when it falls below LTP, what happens? Again, there is a transition from minus Vsat to plus Vsat, and you can see this continues. So when input crosses UTP, it falls to negative saturation, and when input falls below LTP, it switches to plus Vsat. So thereby it converts your sine wave to a square wave. Why this inversion? Because it is an inverting Schmitt trigger. So and you have an hysteresis curve. As I said, this is basically a comparator with hysteresis. And what is hysteresis? The difference between the two threshold points, UTP and LTP, we will call it as hysteresis. And this is given as UTP minus LTP, which ends up being 2R2 by R1 plus R2. And what is R2 by R1 plus R2? It is dependent on the feedback components used, that is R1 and R2. So I will call it as feedback factor, and hysteresis becomes 2 beta into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. And if I want to plot the hysteresis curve, it could it looks something like this. We have a plot of output versus input. So you can see in this hysteresis curve, the output is at positive saturation unless the input is greater than UTP. Once the input exceeds UTP, what happens? It switches from plus Vsat to minus Vsat and continues to be in Vsat till the input falls below the LTP. When input falls below the LTP, it again switches to plus Vsat. So this is your hysteresis curve. So and you can see it is centered around 0. You want to shift this left or right, we add a reference voltage. Now we will take up an inverting Schmitt trigger with a reference voltage. So what we do here is adding a positive hysteresis curve is either shifted to left or right depending on whether we have a positive reference voltage or a negative reference voltage. We will take one case, we will add a positive reference voltage and we will see how the hysteresis curve is going to be shifted. And the same argument holds good, or the same discussion holds good when you put a negative reference voltage. Only thing is it is shifted in the opposite direction. So we will take up an inverting Schmitt trigger with a positive reference voltage. So in the previous discussion we noticed that the hysteresis curve is centered around the origin. If you want to shift it to either to left or right, we need to add a reference voltage. So we will see what happens when I add a reference voltage, positive reference voltage, how the hysteresis is shifted, either how it is shifted. We will just see how, whether it is shifted to the right or left. So same, we have an inverting Schmitt trigger. So when I say inverting Schmitt trigger, the input is applied to the inverting terminal. And the reference, the output is connected back to the input through the feedback resistors R1 and R2. Because I want to shift the reference voltage, I add a reference voltage here. So you can see it is a circuit with positive reference voltage. This is R1 and this happens to be R2. Now the circuit works in a similar fashion we discussed earlier. You can see that the upper threshold and lower threshold points, they are altered because of the inclusion of this reference voltage. Because we have included the reference voltage here, the threshold points depends on this reference voltage. So if initially we assume the same, we will continue with the same discussion. Initially we assume the output is at positive saturation, and the reference voltage, what? The output continues to be in its positive saturation unless Vin is less than this particular reference voltage. When once Vin crosses this upper threshold point, the output switches from plus Vsat to minus Vsat. So in what is for reference voltage, we call it as upper threshold point UTP, or you can also call it as VUTP, and that is going to be what? Output, because it is at positive saturation, plus Vsat. And what is to be accounted for? Voltage drop across R2 is to be accounted for. So it is Vsat, but you observe a voltage source in this in series here. So we need to subtract that voltage source. We need to consider voltage drop across R2 alone minus VR2 into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. This is voltage drop across R2, plus we need to consider this voltage source as well. So it becomes plus VR. So this is your upper threshold point.
Yeah,
R2 into VSAT divided by R1 plus R2, and we end up getting R plus R1 into V reference divided by R1 plus R2. And you are aware R2 by R1 plus R2 is beta. So I can write it as beta into VSAT divided by R1 plus R2 plus V reference by R1 plus R2. So this is your upper threshold point. So if you proceed in a similar fashion, your lower threshold point is minus VSAT minus VR into R2 divided by R1 plus R2 plus VR. So you simplify this, you end up getting it as minus beta VSAT plus R1 VR divided by R1 plus R2. So as a result, you can see, if you can write a hysteresis curve corresponding to this UTP and LTP, your UTP corresponds to this value and your LTP corresponds to this point. As a result, you end up getting an hysteresis curve something like this. So it is it continues to be in I value until your input crosses your UTP value. So once it crosses UTP value, it falls to the low negatives, it is driven towards negative saturation. It continues to be in negative saturation till your input falls below the lower threshold point. Once the input falls below the lower threshold point, it goes to the positive saturation. As an effect, by the inclusion of your reference voltage, has shifted the hysteresis curve to the right of the curve which you would observe without this reference voltage. So in the original without reference voltage, you would see the hysteresis curve was centered around the zero voltage. Now it has been shifted to the right. So if I just reverse this voltage source, if I add a negative reference voltage, you would see the hysteresis curve. You do the similar analysis, you will see the hysteresis curve will be shifted to the other end of around the zero. So it is going to be shifted to this. So you can do the similar analysis by considering the negative reference voltage. So this is with respect to inverting Schmitt trigger. So inverting Schmitt trigger is a Schmitt trigger circuit wherein the input voltage is applied to the inverting terminal, and you have two threshold points which allows the output to be switched from positive saturation to negative saturation, or negative saturation to positive saturation, depending on the threshold points. And your threshold points are determined by this feedback components. It depends on the feedback factor, which in turn depends on R1 and R2. So this is basically inverting Schmitt trigger with positive reference voltage. Next we will take up a non-inverting Schmitt trigger with the reference voltage. Next we have is a non-inverting Schmitt trigger wherein the input is applied to the non-inverting terminal of the Schmitt trigger. So the input along with the feedback is applied to the non-inverting terminal of the Schmitt trigger. We will discuss this, the working of a non-inverting Schmitt trigger, in the next class. We will also take up a couple of problems on design of your Schmitt triggers in the next class. Thank you.